On the 14th of June, SpaceX's third integrated flight test achieved something incredible. And I was there to witness it while helping my friend, everyday astronaut, to film the event. It reached space for the first time, successfully lighting all 33 of its Methalox engines, while also performing its second hot staging separation, where the heavy booster powers down all but three of its engines, while the six second stage engines light before separation occurs, which is a huge improvement over the last test launch, where the booster exploded and Starship failed to reach space due to a fire caused by a planned oxygen dump. This successful maneuver allowed the second stage Starship to soar past the Kármán line, achieving a max altitude of 234 kilometers, just short of the orbit altitude of the ISS. SpaceX could have performed a boost burn to achieve orbit, but with so much left to figure out, including the out-of-control rolling that prevented it from performing a re-entry burn, SpaceX aimed for a suborbital launch. This prevented Starship from becoming the largest piece of space junk in the history of spaceflight. Starship is massive, standing at 121 meters tall. It's not just the most powerful rocket ever made, it's the biggest. And its powerful Raptor engines, the first full-flow staged combustion cycle engines to ever fly, are capable of pushing 150 tons into low Earth orbit. Instead, it re-entered the atmosphere at hypersonic speeds, providing incredible footage. There is no publicly available footage of the space shuttle during re-entry. I know because I looked for it for our documentary on the space shuttle. We had to create our own animations instead. As far as I can tell, this is the first high-definition footage of a re-entry plasma cloud. That plasma cloud caused the space shuttle to enter a communication blackout as the free electrons in it prevent radio communication. But SpaceX has something the space shuttle didn't, Starlink, allowing it to communicate upwards rather than downwards through the plasma cloud. This is all incredible. So what now? What does this mean and how does it change the face of the space industry? At this point, you might be overwhelmed with the amount of new rockets. It seems that every divorced billionaire is starting a rocket company, in the same way a divorced middle-aged man buys a Mazda Miata. But unlike the Miata, Starship is capable of carrying more than just one sad, lonely person. Starship is capable of launching more into orbit than anything before it, and with that capability comes a whole lot of new possibilities. Not only is the Starship the most powerful rocket ever made, it's intended to be fully reusable, with both the heavy booster and second stage being designed to land back on Earth to be refurbished and reused. SpaceX have stated that the goal of Starship is to serve as the primary transport method between Earth orbit, the Moon, and Mars. But is this truly their goal, or is this simply a way to launch even more constellation satellites into orbit around Earth, which is currently the largest driver of revenue in the space industry by a large margin? Some points of design would suggest this ambition is sincere. The use of methane as a fuel source is a huge departure from tradition in the rocket industry. Methane sits in an awkward middle ground between the two most popular fuels. It provides better performance than kerosene, but not as good as hydrogen. And it's easier to store than hydrogen, but not as easy as kerosene. Its benefits are only now becoming useful as SpaceX works to unlock the magic of reusable rockets. Methane serves as a particularly advantageous fuel for the Starship vehicle, especially for its missions involving landing on Mars and returning to Earth. Methane can be synthesized directly on Mars, facilitating the crucial refueling process needed for the return journey. The Martian atmosphere has an abundance of carbon dioxide, providing the key ingredient for the saboteur process, an efficient method of methane production. This chemical reaction combines carbon dioxide with hydrogen in the presence of a nickel catalyst under high temperatures and pressures. Carbon dioxide has the highest freezing point of any gas in the Martian atmosphere. This allows us to extract carbon dioxide from the air by simply cooling the air, in a process that is essentially the opposite of distillation. This also condenses the carbon dioxide into a liquid at the same time. The hydrogen used in the process is a larger issue, which will require water deposits on Mars to be found and mined. These are obviously long-term goals, but methane provides a more immediate benefit in SpaceX's ambitions for reusability. The Raptor engines of the Starship are the first liquid rocket engines to utilize a full-flow combustion cycle in flight. The F1 engines used in the Apollo missions were powered by an open cycle. So, what does this mean? Liquid propellants need to be pumped at very high pressures to provide the thrusts necessary for launch. This requires a lot of power. In the Saturn V, a portion of the fuel and oxidizer was redirected to burn to power a turbine. This turbine then drove pumps that significantly increased the pressure of the liquids. The heat of combustion could easily melt these turbines, and thus, to lower the temperatures involved, the fuel mixture is kept fuel-rich, resulting in cooler combustion. Fuel-rich mixtures, however, burn with a lot of soot. The dark cloud here, above the Merlin engine's nozzle, is the sooty pre-burner turbine exhaust. This exhaust does not contribute to thrust and is just thrown overboard. This is what an open cycle is, and it's a little wasteful. The Raptor engines are closed cycle. They don't waste any fuel, but there are two large problems to overcome: the heat of combustion melting the turbines and the potential of soot from unburned fuel clogging complex mechanisms. These are critical concerns for single-use engines, but the Raptor engines need to perform reliably time after time after time. Methane helps solve one of these problems. Methane consists of a single carbon molecule, reducing the potential formation of long carbon chain soot particles. The Raptor engine runs all of its fuel and oxidizer through pre-burners, with the fuel turbopump running a fuel-rich mixture and the liquid oxygen turbopump running an oxygen-rich mixture. The excess fuel and oxygen from either side then combine in the combustion chamber in their gaseous state where combustion is completed. However, that oxygen-rich mixture in the pre-burner could easily cause elevated combustion temperatures that could destroy the liquid oxygen turbopump. So how does SpaceX get around that? Conventional closed-cycle engines only push a small fraction of the fuel and oxidizer through the turbopumps. The Raptor engine's full-flow cycle passes all of the fuel and oxidizer through the turbopumps. This amount of mass flow means the temperature rise required to run the turbine is much lower, reducing the thermal loads on the turbine blades. However, the hot, oxygen-rich gas coming out of the pre-burner still needs special attention. SN8 showed what happens when oxygen-rich gases are allowed to interact with reactive materials. During its flight, decreasing head pressures in the fuel tank shifted the combustion to an oxygen-rich environment that reacted with copper, melting the engine. Flashing green copper flames preceded the ship being engulfed in flames. SpaceX is casting its Raptor parts in a specially developed Inconel alloy, an oxidation and heat-resistant nickel-chromium alloy to help combat this problem. These engines have proven their ability to push this absolutely mammoth rocket to orbit, but there is still plenty left to do to fulfill SpaceX's grand vision. The gigantic boosters still need to land. The super heavy booster of IFT-3 lit its engines for Starship's first ever landing burn, but it experienced a rapid, unscheduled disassembly at 462 meters in altitude. During its initial supersonic descent, things seemed pretty stable, but then as it relit its engines while it flew past this auto-cumulus cloud, it appeared to be hit by some heavy wind shear and was knocked out of stable flight. The grid fins can be seen frantically trying to get it back into a stable position before it exploded at 462 meters in altitude. Wind shear is to be expected, but it appears that the booster was traveling faster than planned, and stability and control is affected massively by velocity. With IFT-4, SpaceX will likely work to decrease velocity quicker. However, unlike their Falcon counterparts, the Starship's heavy booster will not have landing legs. SpaceX is instead planning to catch the booster with mechanical arms, flying back to the launch pad that it originally launched from. This removes the need for heavy landing legs, but also reduces the likelihood of the powerful Raptor engines destroying the landing pad on landing. Landing where it took off from also has other benefits. With all the necessary infrastructure to refuel and relaunch nearby, the turnaround time for another launch can be reduced. The next challenge in fulfilling SpaceX's ambition is developing full reusability for the second stage. The second stage has 6 Raptor engines, with 3 of them being adapted for use in a vacuum with much larger engine nozzles. These engines successfully boosted the second stage to space, but could not relight because the second stage began to roll. If we stabilize the footage of re-entry, we really get a sense of how much it was rolling out of control, and once it rolled onto its side, it began to tumble end over end too. But despite that, it survived a surprisingly long time. The bulk of Starship's thermal protective system are tiles made out of silica fibers with a fused silica glass coating, made in much the same way that the Space Shuttle's tiles were, although there are likely some minor changes in the formulation, especially as several tiles fell off once again. This is likely a similar issue that the Space Shuttle solved by gluing its tiles to a Nomex strain isolation pad first, allowing the metal to flex and bend beneath the tiles without transferring that movement to the tiles. However, SpaceX has one massive advantage over the Space Shuttle. It's made out of steel, not aluminium. Steel has a much higher operating temperature than the aluminium airframe of the Space Shuttle. And that's pretty apparent as Starship survived a surprisingly long time while rolling and tumbling at hypersonic speeds. Starship also has a lower ballistic coefficient than the Space Shuttle. When flying on its belly with its fuel and oxidizer tanks mostly empty, it has a large surface area and low weight that drag can act on quickly. That's a low ballistic coefficient, whereas a dense, aerodynamically optimized bullet has a very high ballistic coefficient. The Space Shuttle was a fascinating design, but much of its aerodynamics were influenced by the Air Force, who demanded that it could fly 2,000 kilometers laterally in order to return to its launch site after a single orbit. This is not something the Starship will need. I have no doubt in my mind that they can survive re-entry if they can get these control issues solved. But hypersonic stability and control is not an easy problem, and we don't have many ways to test solutions. This is something SpaceX will need to iron out with more testing, and thankfully, they got some incredible data and footage to work off of. Once these problems are solved, SpaceX could have the most capable space launch system ever created on its hands, and it has plans to create multiple variants of the second stage. It can be outfitted for crewed or uncrewed journeys, and can be adapted for carrying cargo or designed specifically for lunar missions. For missions that involve landing on the moon or traveling in deep space, where atmospheric entry is not a concern, it can be configured without fins or a heat shield. In order to transport even more cargo deeper into space, SpaceX has discussed plans to have one second stage variant that is designed to act as an orbital propellant depot. This depot could be filled with 9 missions to orbit, each carrying hundreds of tons of propellant instead of their usual cargo. However, the variant that will get the earliest and most use is the one designed specifically to launch Starlink. SpaceX is gearing up to launch larger versions of the Starlink satellite. Up to now, all Starlink satellites have been constrained by the capabilities of the Falcon 9. Starlink version 1.5 satellites are compact and weigh about 300 kilograms each. With their flat panel design, 60 Starlink satellites can fit into the Falcon 9's 5.2 meter wide payload fairing, maxing out its capacity for low Earth orbit. SpaceX could achieve much more with a larger payload capability. In August 2022, Starlink announced a partnership with T-Mobile to provide a cell network to their customers. Cell phones' antenna are too weak to interact with the signals from Starlink's current satellites. So, going forward, Starlink needs to provide stronger signals to reliably provide a cell network in rural areas. Starship will allow SpaceX to launch larger variants of Starship with larger antenna providing stronger signals. Plans for gigantic space telescopes have also been proposed for the Starship's large fairing. The James Webb Space Telescope's engineering was massively complicated by the size constraints of the Ariane 5. Today's test was just the first of 2024's, and SpaceX has applied for an ambitious 9 launches with the FAA. With each launch, SpaceX will get closer to completing their vision, a huge step forward in our ability to launch massive objects into space. There is still much to be tested and proven, but SpaceX is inching closer to having a fully reusable Starship system that will open the doors for a new generation of communication satellites and a new generation of scientific discovery and space exploration. Throughout this entire story, I've tried not to mention the man behind SpaceX, Elon Musk. That's in part because the man has become so incredibly politically divisive. On one hand, he's helped develop and popularize critical technologies that can help fight climate change, like electric batteries and electric vehicles, something people on the left largely support. On the other hand, he's very popular with the right for his anti-regulation and anti-union support. If you listen to either side, you don't get a full picture of the news. There are three sides to every story: what you think happened, what I think happened, and what actually happened. Ideally, we should be getting the news of all three perspectives, so we get the full picture of current events. Today's sponsor, Ground News, does just that. Ground News is a website and app developed by a former NASA engineer on a mission to give readers an easy, data-driven, objective way to read the news. Every story comes with a quick, visual breakdown of the political bias, factuality, and ownership of the sources reporting, all backed by ratings from three independent news monitoring organizations. To see how Ground News works, let's look at this story on Texas approving a land-swapping deal with SpaceX. Right away, you can see that 21 news outlets have reported on the story. Below that, you can see that 60% of the sources are from central news organizations, 30% are from the left, and 10% are from the right. Up here, we can click on the left, center, and right tabs to get a quick synopsis of how the different sides are discussing the same headline. Like how this left-leaning outlet mentions that the land swap involves a state park, while neither of the right-leaning headlines mention it at all. You can choose a source to read more, and Ground News labels each source with political leaning, a factuality rating, and who owns the news organization, giving you as much information as possible to contextualize the news you are consuming. Something I think we can all agree is something we need today more than ever. Ground News is a fantastic tool for sifting through the constant onslaught of misinformation and bias. They provide all the tools you need to be a critical thinker, and I cannot recommend it enough. In fact, I am offering 30% off their Vantage subscription so you can get cheaper access. You can only access this discount through my link, so go to ground.news/realengineering or click the link in the video description and support an independent news platform working to make the media landscape more transparent.